afternoon, and thank you for joining us for the third and final series of the 2022 Dean Seminar Series. We're pleased to have with us today Dr. Tyler J. VanderWeele. And introducing him will be Dr. Carrie Drews Bosch from George Mason University. If you have questions during the seminar, please submit them via the chat function on the broadcast page or via email to mtomp7@gmu.edu. Thank you, and I'll turn it over to Carrie.
Thank you so much, Michelle. I am excited to introduce Dr. VanderWeele to you. Dr. Tyler VanderWeele is the John L. Loeb and Francis Lehman Loeb Professor of Epidemiology in the Departments of Epidemiology and Biostatistics at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. He is the director of the Human Flourishing Program and co-director of the Initiative on Health and Religion and Spirituality at Harvard University. In addition, Dr. VanderWeele holds faculty appointments at other institutions. He has earned degrees from the University of Oxford, BAs and MAs in math, and a second BA in philosophy and theology from the University of Pennsylvania, an MA in finance and applied economics, and Harvard University, an AM in mathematics and PhD in biostatistics. In 2020, he was awarded an honorary degree of humane letters from Catholic University of America. Dr. VanderWeele is exceedingly well known for his methodologic research aimed at distinguishing between association and causation in the biomedical and social sciences. And I talk about that a lot in my classes. So if you've taken my classes, you will have heard much about Dr. VanderWeele. More recently, his research addresses measurement theory and the importance of incorporating ideas from causal inference and analytic philosophy into measure development and evaluation. His public health research spans perinatal, psychiatric, and social epidemiology, the science of happiness and flourishing, and the study of religion and health, including their roles in end-of-life care. Dr. VanderWeele has authored and co-authored more than 350 publications, along with four books: The Explanation in Causal Inference, Measuring Well-Being, Modern Epidemiology, the Fourth Edition, and Handbook of Religion and Health. In addition, he has presented more than 300 invited addresses, talks, seminars, and currently oversees $10 million in active research funding, largely as a principal investigator. Dr. VanderWeele is a mentor to many master and doctoral students, postdoctoral fellows who've gone on to academic and research positions at leading institutions, including Jaffer Zaidi, who is at our own institution. Dr. VanderWeele is generous with his time, including his past and current editorial board service across disciplines. For example, the Editorial Board for Epidemiology, Journal of Causal Inference, Sociologic Methods and Research, and Journal of Positive Psychology and Well-Being. He is the statistical editor for JAMA Psychiatry. His scholarship and service have earned him notable awards, including the 2012 SPER Rising Star Award, APHA's Mortimer Spiegelman Award, the John Snow Award, Committee of Presidents of Statistical Society's Presidential Award, and his election as Fellow of the American Statistical Association. Welcome, Dr. VanderWeele, and he will talk to us today on the promotion of human flourishing.
Thank you for the kind introduction, Carolyn, and it really is a pleasure being with you all here virtually, at least today. I will be speaking today on the promotion of human flourishing, and this will in some sense be an attempt at taking the ideas, the methods, the perspectives of public health and of epidemiology, and trying to broaden the scope of what it is that we examine and study, to turn not just to questions of physical and mental health, but all of well-being. So I'll make some remarks with regard to what flourishing is and how it might be understood some crude attempts to assess or measure different aspects of flourishing or well-being and some of the work that we've been doing in embedding these measures into various cohort studies. And then in the second half of today's seminar, I'll turn to the question of how can we use some of these ideas and some of this research to in fact promote well-being, to promote flourishing. So I'll talk about some of the activities and interventions for flourishing that have emerged from the research literature and that are evidence-based, but then I'll go on to talk about the importance of communities for different aspects of well-being also, and then make some concluding remarks and hopefully have some time for questions that may emerge during the seminar. More information on the framework, which I will be presenting here, can be found in this 2017 paper in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, and then some of the evidence-based activities for well-being can be found in this other from the Journal of Positive Psychology and Well-Being. More information on the Human Flourishing Program itself at Harvard can be found on the program's website. So if we turn to our various institutions and academic disciplines, we often find that they aspire to grand visions of flourishing. The World Health Organization's definition of health from 1948, still in place today, is that health is a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. The discipline of economics is sometimes described as an attempt to study how agents go about maximizing expected utility, supposedly taking into account all aspects of an agent's preferences. Discipline of positive psychology is sometimes described as the scientific study of the strengths that enable individuals and communities to thrive. So again, very grand visions of flourishing. But if we turn to our actual studies and discussions, we often find that these are restricted to much narrower disease states or simple measures of feeling happy or to income. They miss, in some sense, these grander visions of the foundation of many of these disciplines and pursuits. So what is flourishing? Well, if we turn to our dictionaries, the Oxford English Dictionary defines flourishing as to grow or develop in a healthy or vigorous way. American Heritage Dictionary, to do or fare well. The etymology of the term comes from Latin florere, to bloom, blossom, or flower. It's the word often used to translate Aristotle's eudaimonia, sometimes also translated as happiness. The working definition we've been using at the Human Flourishing Program at Harvard is that flourishing or complete human well-being is living in a state in which all aspects of a person's life are good. So very broad, very all-encompassing, but this is arguably what we are after as individuals and should be seeking as a society. And there have been various conceptualizations and measures of well-being that have been put forward. I think the discipline that's come closest to trying to capture this notion is that of positive psychology, which again has proposed a number of different ways of thinking about well-being and trying to measure it, but notably absent from many of these psychological well-being measures are any notion of physical health and are we really fully flourishing if we're not healthy? Are we fully flourishing if we're bedridden, if we're terribly ill? And you know, I think some of this is because these psychological well-being measures focus almost exclusively on the mind, on psychology itself, and consequently miss physical health, which of course we know in public health is central to well-being. Often missing from many of these conceptualizations and measurement approaches are any notion of character or virtue, contrary to Plato or Aristotle, most of the Western philosophical tradition and really philosophical, religious, cultural traditions worldwide. But with a conception so broad, we might wonder, is it ever really possible to measure, to assess flourishing? And can we achieve any sort of consensus around doing so? I mean, surely with a notion as broad as flourishing, conceptions as to what this will include will likely vary across persons and cultures and philosophical and religious traditions. So can we achieve any sort of consensus? Can we really make any progress with regard to empirical measurement or study? And what I would argue is that while I think it is indeed the case that understandings of flourishing will vary across different traditions, I think that we can begin by looking at and thinking about those aspects of well-being that seem to be common across different traditions. And so what I would argue is that whatever else flourishing may include, any reasonable conception of flourishing would include these following five domains of human life. Not that flourishing is reducible to these five, but again, any reasonable conception, I think, would include, perhaps amongst other things, these five as well. And these are happiness and life satisfaction, physical and mental health, meaning and purpose, character and virtue, and close social relationships. Again, the argument's not that these exhaust flourishing, but I think each is arguably a part of it. I think each of these five domains also satisfies the following two criteria. Each is nearly universally desired, and we actually have some empirical data to support this now as well. And each is also an end in itself. It's sought for its own sake and not merely as a means to some other ends. And I think these two criteria, being nearly universally desired and being an end, might be useful in shaping consensus around what to measure. And so as a brief assessment of flourishing, a crude assessment, we've taken two questions in each of those five domains, essentially drawn principally from the existing well-being literature, questions which are have fairly widespread use and which have received some degree of empirical validation. And we use these two questions in each of the five domains to try to get some sense as to how people are doing across these domains of well-being. The only questions which were really newly developed were those on character. And although I think a lot of very good work has been done on character assessment over the last couple of decades, most of it requires a fairly extensive assessment to just understand or assess a single character strength. There was very little that was more global in nature, making use of single item assessment. So we worked with the philosophers building on the tradition of the cardinal virtues, the notion that the foundation of the moral virtues lie four. That's called practical wisdom or prudence, justice, fortitude or courage, and moderation or temperance. And so these are the 10 questions that we've been using in practice. The first domain, happiness and life satisfaction. The first question, how satisfied are you with life as a whole these days? Scored 0 to 10, 0 completely unsatisfied, 10 completely satisfied. And this is perhaps one of the most widely used well-being questions in the literature. It's used in the UK's annual survey by the OECD in Gallup and various cohort studies. It'll be in this year's US Health Interview survey as well. And so that's more cognitive, and it's supplemented then by a question that's somewhat more affective in nature. In general, how happy or unhappy do you usually feel? 0 extremely unhappy, 10 extremely happy. And the second domain, fairly standard self-reported physical and mental health questions drawn from the US General Social Survey, the World Health Organization's Mental Health Survey. In general, how would you rate your physical health 0 to 10? How would you rate your overall mental health 0 to 10? The third domain, meaning and purpose. First, overall, to what extent do you feel the things you do in your life are worthwhile? This is, again, a very widely used well-being question. Once again, UK's annual survey, OECD, a number of cohort studies make use of this question as well. And then that's supplemented by something more cognitive, and understand my purpose in life. Zero completely disagree, 10 completely agree. The fourth domain, character and virtue, a first question intended in some crude way to try to assess practical wisdom and justice. I always act to promote good in all circumstances, even in difficult and challenging situations. Zero, not at all true of me, 10, completely true of me. And then second question intended in some crude way to try to assess fortitude and temperance. I'm always able to give up some happiness now for a greater happiness later. And then the fifth domain, close social relationships. These two questions were taken from the UK campaigns to end loneliness survey of short measurement instruments. First item, I'm content with my friendships and relationships, scored zero to 10, essentially trying to get at the quantity of those relationships. And then second, my relationships are as satisfying as I would like them to be, intended in some way trying to get at the quality of those relationships. And so in most of our work, we looked at these domains separately, because as we'll see, the dynamics across domains can in fact be quite different. Occasionally, we will also take an average of those 10 questions as a summary score for flourishing, but really this ought not to be understood anything other than an average of those five more meaningful assessments. We typically do supplement these 10 questions with two others on financial and material stability, essentially trying to assess the means to sustain these other ends. And these questions from simply from the financial well-being literature. First, how often do you worry about being able to meet normal monthly living expenses? Zero, worry all the time. 10, do not worry at all. How often do you worry about safety, food, or housing? And so sometimes we'll take an average of all 12 for a more secure flourishing index, perhaps less satisfactory conceptually, since these financial resources are means, not ends, but perhaps more satisfactory in practice, indicating flourishing over a longer period of time. And we've talk about shortly, we've used these questions in a number of different workplace and educational, clinical, and research settings. I think in addition to being valuable for research and assessment, I think can also be helpful for self reflection, to kind of understand how and which aspects of life are going well and which are not, for identifying areas of life to where one thinks one might want to make changes in life or try to work on or improve, for tracking over time to understand how things are changing. I try to go through these at least once a quarter myself to again try to get insight into how life is going and where I perhaps need to spend greater attention. And when we've used these in these different settings, some of the feedback that we've had simply answering the questions has been as follows. Some questions made me stop and think, or it was pretty eye-opening to see the areas that I really need to work on, or relief that someone is asking, I want help in certain areas, or slightly caught off guard with the questions around purpose, missing a greater purpose, need to reach out to help more and give back. So again, in addition to, I think, empowering research on the distribution and determinants of well-being, and we found that in some ways, the asking these questions themselves constitutes an intervention which can help with reflection and can help improve well-being. So just to give you, some sense as to how these questions might be useful in practice and understanding what's taken place, this is data from 2020 on roughly nationally representative samples of the United States on each of these domains in January 2020, prior to the WHO declaration of the COVID-19 pandemic, and then 6 months later in June 2020, in the midst of the pandemic. And what you'll see is that in January 2020, most of the means in the United States were around 7 across those domains, other than financial and material stability, which was about 6. And then during the COVID-19 pandemic, unsurprisingly, the flourishing declined. But interestingly, different domains were affected in different ways. Happiness and life satisfaction fell pretty substantially, then perhaps unsurprisingly, 7/10 of a point. Physical and mental health, again, probably unsurprisingly, likewise fell fairly substantially, 7/10 of a point. Largest fall in financial material stability, that declined nearly a full point. And June 2020 was the height of unemployment in the United States as well. But interestingly, some of the other domains did not change as much. Meaning and purpose declined a little bit, but not all that much. Our character assessments were effectively level. And somewhat surprisingly, close social relationships declined a little, but not much, not as much as we would have anticipated. And this has been corroborated by other studies as well. So it seems people have found ways to connect either with those family members or those they're living with, or perhaps with relatives and friends via Zoom and other technologies. Importantly, though, the standard deviations in all of these domains have increased. There's greater variability during the pandemic than before. And so these means disguise what have been quite variable experiences. So while perhaps for some, this period has been a time of investing in relationships, for others, perhaps especially those living alone, this has been a challenging time. But in any case, these sorts of data give us insight into what's happening, what's going well, what's not, what things need improvement, who's doing well and who's not, and who might we reach out to try to help in different ways. So we've been collecting this data in a number of different settings, workplace settings, employees at Aetna, Polar, Orange, Corning, the World Bank, factory workers in Mexico, Poland, Sri Lanka, Cambodia, and China, group of international flight attendants, a number of clinical settings, mental health patients at Boston University, at Johns Hopkins, at University of Pittsburgh's Medical Center, in different educational contexts, including Yale, Stony Brook, New York University and West Point, secondary schools in the US, UK, India, China, various communities will be embedded in this year's Nurses' Health Study assessments, along with LSPAC and the cohort study in the UK and the Japanese aging and gerontological epidemiologic study as well. As I'll comment on briefly, we will also be launching a major global flourishing study to try to better understand and study the determinants of these various aspects of well-being. Some of the patterns we've noticed in many of these samples, which we've collected data on to try to understand well-being and also to try to empower research on this topic. So the patterns that have emerged is that the financial domain is often ranked the lowest, not in all samples. It's not the case, for example, in the Aetna employee sample, but in many samples, having those financial material means is and continues to be a real challenge. We've also found, somewhat disturbingly, that social connectedness is rated notably lower in the United States than most other countries. So we're not doing so well in that domain, perhaps area for improvement here in the United States. We've also found that across these dimensions of well-being, the most recent data suggests these are increasing with age, really up into individuals' 70s and 80s. And this is somewhat in contrast with some of the earlier work on well-being, which suggested more of a U-shaped curve, with those who were younger and older doing better, and those midlife struggling more with respect to well-being and happiness. And what we found really across these dimensions, these domains of flourishing, is that left part of the U has been flattening. Young people are not doing as well as they used to be. And this also, I think, is real cause for concern. And again, the dynamics do differ across these domains. And while we find that happiness and life satisfaction tend to be higher in richer developed countries than in poor developing countries, the reverse is the case. with meaning and purpose, which tend to be higher in poor developing countries than the richer developed world. And this, you know, likewise, I think raises questions with regard to how can we go about economic development and growth in a way which doesn't compromise meaning and purpose. So in any case, these are some of the insights that have emerged, or some of the patterns that we've seen thus far. To try to empower the study of well-being, of flourishing yet further, we have recently launched a global flourishing study in collaboration with Gallup, Harvard and Baylor University. And this study will involve 22 countries around the world with nationally representative sampling in each country. It will include a total of 240,000 individuals, and we'll be asking a series of questions on well-being and its potential determinants, social, political, economic, religious, family-based questions. In these 22 countries, representing about half the world's population, we'll be asking these questions every year for 5 years to, again, try to understand both the distribution of well-being, but also, hopefully, as we collect data over time, its determinants. This will be an open access data resource. The Center for Open Science will be hosting, so anyone's welcome to make use of it. Data collection is already underway, and we hope will be complete for the first wave of data by the end of the calendar year. And again, we hope this sort of study will give us greater insight into the distribution and determinants of well-being. So I do want to transition now to make some remarks on how we can go about improving well-being. And this has been of interest in the positive psychology literature for decades. And various randomized trials have looked at different sorts of well-being interventions or do-it-yourself activities, have evaluated these in randomized trials, and I think have found important effects on various aspects of happiness and health. So some examples of these are gratitude activities, and this is perhaps the best studied activity or approach. There's some variation with regard to what precisely is done, but it's often things like for 6 weeks, three times a week, write down three things you're grateful for and why. And groups randomized to such gratitude activities versus some sort of neutral writing activity are found to have higher levels of happiness, lower levels of depressive symptoms, better quality sleep, lower self-reported health symptoms, and some of these outcomes persist even 6 months later. My family and I practice this several times a week, and I do find it helpful. When we don't, I feel I notice a change in the family dynamics. But in any case, again, dozens of randomized trials have looked at these gratitude interventions. Another sort of activity that's been well studied in randomized trials are acts of kindness interventions. These often something along the lines of five, choose one day each week for say 5 or 10 weeks, choose a single day on which to carry out five acts of kindness that you wouldn't otherwise do. And it can take quite a bit of advanced planning to try to get five in a single day, but the evidence suggests five in a single day is better, is more effective than five spread out over the course of a week. But again, these have been found to increase levels of happiness and decrease depressive symptoms, increase a sense of engagement in life. Yet another example are the use of character strengths. As an example, one kind of tries to identify amongst a list of character strengths one's five top character strengths, and then you try to use each of them in a new way each week. And this has likewise been found to improve happiness, lower depressive symptoms, even 6 months out. Penn's Positive Psychology website has a little character assessment, which one can use to to do this sort of thing. And then, you know, various other interventions have easy, do-it-yourself interventions have been developed to try to address the negative side, forms of psychological distress. David Byrne's Feeling Good book has been tested in a number of randomized trials and found fairly substantial effects on lowering depressive symptoms. Barlow and Kresge's Mastery of Your Anxiety and Panic has been evaluated just in one relatively small randomized trial. So I think more work needs to be done to have the conclusions firm, but likewise, effects on alleviating anxiety. As yet another example, Worthington's forgiveness workbook interventions help those who are struggling with anger and who want to forgive but are having a difficult time doing so to release that anger, to forgive the offender. And we're currently trying to provide definitive evaluation of these workbooks in a randomized trial in five countries and relatively high conflict areas: Colombia, South Africa, Ukraine, Hong Kong, and Indonesia. Because initial evidence suggests these have effects not just on improving forgiveness, but also on reducing depression and anxiety and increasing hope. If that's the case, these various workbooks and resources could be disseminated quite broadly to try to improve mental health as well as creating more forgiving societies. So some of these and other sorts of activities for well-being are summarized in this paper in the Journal of Positive Psychology and well-being with kind of references to the randomized trials that have been carried out along with in some cases meta-analyses as well. We've also put together a little Flourishing app which you can access there on this webpage, and it's also available now on Android and from the Apple Store, that does essentially provide fairly simple implementations of some of these activities for flourishing. So the effect sizes of these simple, easy, do-it-yourself interventions aren't huge, but still meaningful. And given the ease of use and the possibility of free dissemination, I do think from a public health perspective, if we were to encourage use of these different sorts of flourishing activities in school places, workplaces, clinical settings through public health efforts, it would, from a population perspective, make quite a difference with regard to well-being. So I do think from a public health perspective, these resources are currently underutilized with regard to promoting well-being. Interestingly, most of these interventions principally from the positive psychology literature have been found to have effects on happiness and to a certain extent on physical and mental health, but the effects are much less clear on the other domains of flourishing, on purpose or character or relationships. These things are perhaps more difficult to alter with just a simple 5-week activity, and many of the interventions, for example, that have tried to increase purpose have failed. Many of these, in fact, are unpublished because of the failure, or one finds the effects fade very rapidly. And so, as I'll discuss in the next few slides, I think to affect these other domains of flourishing, of well-being, we need not just easy do-it-yourself simple activities, but we need deeper investment in communities and longer-term commitments in relationships. I think the evidence suggests that it's these more institutional or longer-term or relational commitments that have the more profound effects on these other aspects of flourishing and purpose, on character, and on relationships. To evaluate this and to try to think about how we might improve flourishing at population level, I think our standard lenses of assessing public health impact can be very helpful. And so often we assess public health impact as a function of two things. First, the prevalence of the exposure and sort of phenomena that we're studying. And then secondly, the size of its effects. Something that is common, population prevalent, and that has large effects is going to shape population health. And so when we apply this public health impact lens to the determinants of physical health, we're led to things like exercise, nutrition, not smoking, getting adequate sleep. But we could broaden the outcomes we're looking at. We could ask, what are the pathways or the exposures, the determinants that are both common in the population and that have large effects, not just on physical health, but also on happiness and life satisfaction and mental health, on meaning and purpose, on character, on relationships. And if we broaden the list of outcomes we're looking at and apply this public health lens, I think the list of the major determinants looks rather different than it does for physical health. And so based on a review of the literature, which I'll be summarizing shortly, I'll propose four. And these four are family, work, education, and religious community. I think there's evidence, considerable evidence from the existing empirical literature that each of these is relatively common, both in the United States and worldwide, and that each has large effects across those five domains of flourishing. Importantly, the argument here is not that these are exhaustive. I think other pathways are very important for particular people. Maybe engagement in the arts is particularly meaningful for some individuals and improves multiple aspects of flourishing, but perhaps that deep engagement is less common at the population level. But in any case, the argument's not that these are exhaustive, nor is the argument that these are necessary. One can flourish even in the absence of one or more of these pathways. Rather, the argument is that each of these powerfully affects the various domains of flourishing, and each is relatively common in the population, so that if individual policy efforts were made to enhance these pathways, I think flourishing would increase at the population level. These conclusions presented in that paper, 2017 paper in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, was based on a literature review where there were certain methodologic restrictions made to try to look at the most rigorous evidence. A restriction was made to longitudinal, experimental, or quasi-experimental designs, cross-sectional designs, which often constitute the vast majority of this literature on well-being. Cross-sectional designs were excluded. Because these are effectively useless for trying to assess causality. It becomes very difficult to work out what causes what with cross-sectional designs when all the data is collected at the same time. For example, it's been known for some time that marriage and happiness are correlated, but is that because marriage increases happiness, or is that because happy people are more likely to go on to get married? And I think there's in fact evidence from good studies for both, but from cross-sectional designs, you can't tell. Likewise, religious service participation is correlated with lower depression rates, but is that because religious service attendance protects against depression? Or is it because people who are depressed withdraw from religious communities and other forms of community life as well? And again, I think there is evidence for both, but we can't tell from cross-sectional data. So ideally, we want studies which have longitudinal data controlling for outcomes at baseline to try to rule out reverse causation. Ideally, we want to assess the robustness of those results, the potential unmeasured and confounding. Ideally, evidence from multiple sources, maybe meta-analyses of longitudinal studies. And in some cases, this restriction to longitudinal studies did require discarding the vast majority of the studies. When I carried out this literature review in 2017, although there were over 100 studies on just service attendance and happiness and life satisfaction at the time, I think only one was longitudinal. There have been a few since then, but in any case, this literature review, again, was restricted to the most rigorous sorts of studies. And so this next figure kind of presents a summary of the evidence on the left-hand side of the four proposed pathways to flourishing, the right-hand side, the five domains. And each of these numbers on the arrows corresponds to references in the paper to a longitudinal experimental or quasi-experimental design providing evidence for these effects. So in some cases, I would say the evidence is quite strong. In other cases, maybe only one or two studies and further research is needed to confirm. But again, more details on this literature review in that paper. But again, I think some of the implications of this are that at a policy level, what we want to do to increase well-being for populations is to implement policies that will enhance these various pathways of family, work, education, and religious community. And I think a lot of our policy decisions today are made chiefly through an economic lens. How is this going to affect GDP and employment, inflation? And I do think these are important questions. I don't want to downplay the role of economic considerations, but I think we should take a broader lens and think not just about economics, but about some of these other aspects of well-being also. With regard to work, I think welfare policies shouldn't disincentivize work. I think well-intentioned welfare programs that provide food and healthcare are good, but work provides more than that. Work also provides a set of relationships, an opportunity to use one's abilities and strengths, a sense of meaning. And so while providing for people's material needs and means is important, I think one does not want to disincentivize work because it enhances flourishing in these other ways as well. And so I think things like supportive employment programs for disadvantaged and mentally ill are very promising, and randomized trials have suggested longer term effects on finding and sustaining in employment. But I think work is an important pathway to flourishing. Likewise, with respect to marriage, I think some states have what are sometimes called marriage penalties in the welfare system, where two people lose their welfare benefits if they become married, discouraging marriage, and both for the well-being of the partners and children. The research suggests that marriage is very valuable. So I think we need to eliminate these from the welfare system, these marriage penalties. I think another potentially promising intervention is on early online marital counseling programs. And often marital counseling has not been evidence-based, and often it's only turned to either out of desperation or to kind of validate the decision to divorce. And there's now randomized trial evidence that these online interventions, which are much cheaper and less embarrassing to participate in, are effective at improving marital quality. I think widespread dissemination of these sorts of programs could be very valuable. And on the education front, I think ensuring all students have access to good teachers is really critical. Numerous analyses suggesting the benefits of good education. And I think that the real estate-based school funding is somewhat problematic because it keeps poor communities from having access to better teachers. Likewise, I think an argument can be made for greater parental choice with regard to schooling options, given that education affects not only academic outcomes, but these other flourishing outcomes. I think giving parents choice on kind of the ends to pursue with regard to education is likewise valuable. And with regard to religion, strong evidence that participation in religious community, weekly attendance affects all of these different well-being outcomes. Maintaining religious liberty and retaining status for these institutions is important. Likewise, correcting unbalanced portrayals in media and academy, which tend to focus on the negative aspects of religion and religious life. And certainly there have been problems, and those problems need to be pointed out and addressed and corrected. But I think at present, there's an unbalanced portrayal of these religious communities, and there's been an absence of pointing towards the many positive things that they contribute, both to individuals' lives who participate, but also with regard to homeless shelter programs, food kitchens, Alcoholics Anonymous programs, healthcare services, and so on. So I think there needs to be a more balanced portrayal in the media and the academy to support religious community as a pathway to flourishing as well. So these are just some ideas with regard to what might be done to try to enhance these pathways to promote population level flourishing. I think enhancing each of these different pathways has the potential to have profound effects on well-being. And I think broadening the lens of considerations to include well-being is important. So we're taking, we've done a fair bit of work in trying to embed these measures in various cohort studies and launching this global flourishing study. We are well underway with that work. We're also trying to expand this work in other directions as well, looking at measures of community well-being or spiritual well-being even, which I think have to be shaped more around individual religious and spiritual traditions. I'm trying to incorporate additional non-Western perspectives and work funded by the Wellbeing for Planet Earth Foundation, carried out by Gallup, trying to see how well-being is understood in other areas of the world. Concepts like peace and balance and harmony seem to be given greater emphasis there than perhaps in Western context. So bringing in these perspectives as well. And then finally, trying to adapt these assessments to other more particular contexts. We have an adolescent flourishing assessment now. I think there are interesting questions on what does flourishing look like and in the end of life, for example. So these are some of the directions we've been moving in. Few concluding remarks then. Again, I think flourishing is this broad, all-encompassing notion pertaining to all aspects of a person's life. I think this is ultimately what we're seeking. And because that's so, I think this notion of well-being and flourishing should have greater penetration with regard to how we're focusing our research efforts and policy efforts as well. So I think we should start looking at these different aspects of well-being, embedding them into our research studies. Elsewhere, I've proposed what I'm calling an outcome-wide epidemiologic design, where we look at a single exposure, but look at the effects on numerous outcomes in a single paper simultaneously to give us a better sense as to what is shaping different aspects of well-being and what sorts of interventions or exposures affect not just one or two, but a whole host of outcomes in positive ways. I think we need better research support, both in terms of government funding and university hiring and promotion on some of these other outcomes, on unhappiness, on meaning, on character, on social relationships. I think government should start tracking flourishing, and there's been quite a bit of progress over the last decade or two on this. The UK, as I said, OECD is doing this routinely, and we're just beginning here in the United States. We've got one question now in the US Health Interview survey this year, but more work to be done. And likewise, I think employers, medical centers, universities could start tracking flourishing over time, trying to improve it. And I do think all of this matters. I think what we measure shapes what we discuss, what we know, what we aim for, and the policies put in place to achieve it. So I think we should be aiming at flourishing both personally and as a community. That concludes my presentation. Thank you all for listening and happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much for that eye-opening presentation. There's so much here to think about and to act on. We do have one question in the chat, and I want to encourage others to submit questions via the chat function or directly to my email, which is mtomp7@gmu.edu. The question that we have in the chat is, how young have you measured well-being? Would it be appropriate for school age population or at least adolescents? I ask in part because I saw your 2019 article that speaks to studying community well-being, and you mentioned schools. Great work, thank you.
Thank you, and good question, important question. Thus far, we have used these assessments with school age children ages 12 to 18. We have an adolescent assessment which takes those 12 questions but replaces four of the 12 with something more age appropriate. It's worked quite well in those settings. I'd be hesitant at this point to use it the assessment below age 12, but we are beginning to do some work on 10 9, 10, 11 year olds probably will be doing further question adaptation for that group. How that plays out, I don't know. But I think ages 12 to 18 has been working reasonably well. We do have as I mentioned towards the end, we do have a community well-being assessment also, which can be adapted to different contexts, including school contexts, but also family, city, national, workplace contexts. And we have collected that community well-being assessment from both staff and students at middle schools and high schools. So again, more information on those can be found on the Flourishing Program website. And we are now launching a new, more substantial initiative on flourishing in educational context to try to promote more of this work, both with regard to assessment, but also what interventions in practice among students seem to be most effective. So that work is ongoing. My own view is that while educational contexts really do have as the principal end that academic learning and development that should always be prioritized, I think it is an extraordinary opportunity to promote well-being also.
Another question from the audience: have you approached the NIH All of Us study to include flourishing questions?
I have not, but I really should. I just submitted a month or two ago something to the UK Biobank, and it would be very good to do so to the NIH as well. So I will add that to my to-do list. Thank you very much for the suggestion.
What is your hypothesis or your thoughts around how this data has changed over the past 20 years, and maybe what some of those influences have been on changes in happiness or flourishing?
Yeah. I think it does vary across domains, and of course across countries as well. The World Happiness Report has looked at life satisfaction, life evaluation for about 10 years now in roughly 150, 160 countries using Gallup's data. That's repeated cross-sectional rather than longitudinal panel data. So useful for tracking trends, but not as useful for trying to understand the determinants of well-being. And in many countries, happiness has been stable, or maybe in some has gone up a bit. There was definitely a dip during the COVID-19 pandemic. Our most recent data suggests that on average in the United States, we've returned to kind of pre-pandemic levels in most of these domains, but the distribution actually looks different. Again, young people continue to, it seems to be not doing as well, and you know, surprisingly across these various domains. So the recovery has not been entirely uniform. With a lot of these other domains of flourishing, the answer is we just don't know. We've not done adequate data collection. Again, we have, I think, reasonably good data on happiness and life satisfaction, but there are real disputes in the United States whether loneliness has increased over the last five decades or not. I would say the best data we have suggests that it has gone up over the last five decades, but it's disputed, and disputed on very reasonable grounds, to the point where I'd say from the empirical data, we don't know. There is some more recent data suggesting that it has been increasing the last 10 years, at least amongst adolescents and college age students, possibly reversing the prior 10 years. But going back further than that, we just don't know. I mean, likewise, I think it's somewhat similar with regard to questions of meaning and purpose, say. And you know, the fact that something is important and that has received as much attention in the media and in some policy discussions as loneliness, that we don't have good data on this is somewhat shocking. So I think we really do need to do better at tracking these things at institutional and community and national levels as well.
And you mentioned media. That is a question that I have, the role of media, not just social media, all media. What are your thoughts on the role that media has in our happiness or our perceived happiness?
I would say the best studies don't suggest very positive effects. You know, there have been a handful of longitudinal studies now with regard to social media use, suggesting, I mean, especially at higher levels of use, detrimental effects both on unhappiness and on poorer mental health. Though, you know, it does seem to vary somewhat by age. And then, you know, with regard to just regular mainstream media, television, say, news reporting, strong evidence that the content of news media has become much, much more negative over the last five decades. I mean, talking 2 to 3 standard deviations more negative on these assessments. And some of it is because that's what people watch, that's what sells. We have what psychologists sometimes call the negativity bias, that we fixate and focus more on what's negative. And so news shows make use of that to get people to stay on the program, but that creates fear, that creates sadness, that creates animosity. And again, experimental evidence suggesting that then goes on to have negative effects on people's interactions with one another. So I do think we have come to a pretty bad equilibrium with regard to current news reporting, where news channels themselves feel to stay alive and to get watchers, viewers, they need to report negative results. But the societal impact that has, I think, is profoundly negative. The effect sizes, again, are going to be small on any given individual at any time, but you start thinking about 300 million people and how those interactions then go on to affect subsequent interactions and the amount of time we spend watching this material, I think it has been profoundly negative. And I do think some of the polarization in this country has arisen from that negative news reporting on both sides. So you know, my view, and I have a short piece on this, the American Journal of Health promotion, is that this is a major public health issue that needs to be addressed. That if news, you know, stations would commit to running, let's say, one positive story for every 3 negative ones, it could make a difference. I think it would likewise require viewers to make a commitment to only engage with those news fora that did that. But it would be one way to try to get ourselves out of what I think has become a very bad equilibrium that we found ourselves in.
Well, you mentioned the responsibility of news organizations and media organizations. Do you see a role for corporate responsibility in general, where maybe corporations have a part to convey not only the information, but to try to help address the issue?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think likewise, the workplace is a highly underutilized opportunity to promote well-being. We spend so much of our time at work. And so what happens at work really does affect our lives. And again, I think evidence from good, rigorous longitudinal studies that well-being in the workplace affects well-being in life. And likewise, well-being in life affects well-being in the workplace. The dynamics are a little different in the two directions, but there are important effects in both directions. And so I think both top-down and bottom-up approaches are needed. So I think in thinking about managerial practices, thinking carefully about work life, home life balance and family is really important. I think providing opportunities in the workplace to develop relationships or to find volunteering opportunities to even promote or disseminate some of these, you know, well-being, simple, easy to use well-being interventions could go a long way. There's nothing specific to the workplace context that some of these interventions requires, but it's just I think, like the educational context, a very easy form for dissemination. But likewise, I think there are things individuals can do to enhance work experience. You've done some work on job crafting and the ideas you think about your work, and you think about your relationships and how they might improve your tasks and how you might do them more efficiently. And you try to connect your actual activities into the broader mission or goals of the organization. And again, randomized trials have suggested that these do-it-yourself job crafting practices increase engagement at work and have the advantage that they can be employed at kind of any level of the occupational hierarchy. Anyone can engage in this sort of job crafting. So I think both with regard to employers and managers thinking about well-being, measuring well-being, trying to reach out to those who are struggling, but also thinking about the workplace itself as a platform for deeper engagement for well-being is a potentially very promising way forward.
Thank you for that. And with that, Carrie, unless you have additional questions for Dr. VanderWeele, I'd like to thank you for joining us today and for giving us so much to think about and closing out this series with a really actionable and positive message.
Yeah, I would just like to echo our thanks for coming and really an interesting topic related to public health, where thinking about public health and bringing things together that are not necessarily the typical medical model that we think about, I think is a really important area for us to think about. So thank you again.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here. It really has been a pleasure, and look forward to hopefully further conversations with many of you in due course. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Great.